Good afternoon and welcome to the podcast. I'm Zach Newman and I'm here with my friends, Daniel.
Dan McQuarrie, how's it going?
Tanner Sechrist.
Hey.
And it's the podcast in the woods. We made it. It's really happening.
Yeah. We are not stalling in the driveway.
Nope. It's for real this time. So we thought that before we get into the movies discussion, that we would just do a little bit of an introduction about ourselves, just to give you a chance to get to know us a little bit. So I'll go first, as I've been assigned to do. My name is Zach Newman. I am currently playing the piano for the living. I thought of a super cool saying for myself. I play the trills to pay the bills.
You know, the fact that we laugh so hard at that tells people exactly what type of podcast this is going to be.
So that's what I do. My involvement with the Dog in the Woods is, well, we're all founding members, first of all. But specifically, I write and I direct, and I also act. Tanner, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Oh, man. So my name's Tanner Sechrist. I'm a student, so I'm the opposite of Zach. I have no trills or bills, but...
You do have bills.
Well, not with me, because I spent them all on school.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Right.
My involvement with the Dog in the Woods is I'm the guy that makes things take twice as long as they have to, because I'm constantly laughing at all of our jokes.
That's not just you.
But it's... Yeah, that's okay. Well, that's what I think I do. But I also act, and then in our last film that we made, I was the head of casting, which that was a time, let me tell you.
Yeah, there was, well, there at was least... a reason that I like made it like specifically a person's job, and also that person wasn't me.
It was probably the third most important job.
Yeah.
But and the third hardest job.
What are the numbers one and two?
Director.
Okay.
And then that's number two. And then number one is actor, which was also me. So I had the first and third.
You had the first and third. Yeah. We all had the first hardest
job. So you think you don't think the person who shot the movie or edited it had a hard job at all?
No, I can do that in my sleep.
You know, I made a 50-second video for my class, and trust me, editing is not easy.
Yeah. All right, so tell us about yourself, Dan.
So I used to be a student here.
Where is here?
We are live from the campus of Tabor College, and
well, we're live. They probably won't listen to it live unless they're listening to it right now.
Us three talking right now are live from the campus of Tabor College,
where we all went to
school. We all went to school. This is the birthing grounds of the Dog in the Woods.
I've never heard the term birthing grounds.
You know, I
I like it.
I start things. That's what I do.
Okay.
I don't end things, I start things.
Yeah. 50 years from now, they're going to trace the origin of that phrase.
Yes.
Birthing grounds.
So my role in our last two movies has mainly been of actor. In our first movie, The Dog in the Woods, I had a little bit more of a creative role. And so I was pretty much the guy that... I think I came up with some pretty good jokes.
I would say so.
And that's why... I mean, I watched The Dog in the Woods a few weeks ago, and I giggled so much through it, and I think most of it because it was exactly my humor, because a lot of the jokes were also mine. So I'm that guy. I don't know, I teach science too. That takes up a lot of my time for high schools.
Probably most of your time.
About 90% of my time, yeah.
Yeah. And the rest of the time you're here with us.
Yes. So I understand for this podcast we are doing each of our three favorite movies.
Right. We all have picked a movie that we really like, and we're each going to talk about in turn, just to sort of give you a sense of like our taste in movies. So the movie that I picked is No Country for Old Men, directed by the Coen brothers. Came out in 2007, and it won a bunch of Oscars. I didn't look up how many Oscars it was. So one of my favorite moments in this movie is the scene where Llewellyn is in the he's in like the second hotel that he's gone to, and he told the guy at the desk, if anyone checks into this hotel, you call me, right? then he's in his hotel room and he finds the sensor in the satchel that's full of money. So he knows the guy's going to show up. And my favorite moment in that scene, well, really two moments in that scene. The first is when he picks up the phone and you hear it ringing and then no one answers, because that builds so much suspense, but it's the simplest thing in the world. Like, he literally just picks up the phone and no one answers. And then you see Sugar's shadow under the door. And so Llewellyn is all tense to, like, you know, fire his gun if he has to. And then the shadow leaves and he turns off the light in the hallway. So you can't see his shadow anymore. So really simple things that really build suspense really well. Another one of my favorite moments is at the end when Carla Jean comes back home and she finds Sugar in her house and he says he's going to kill her. And he says, I can flip the coin. That's the best I can do, you know. And she refuses to call it. She's like, it's not the coin. It's just you. And because he sort of fancies himself this agent of fate, like when he's in the gas station with the attendant and he's like, I got here the same way the coin did. Or no, that's from the scene at the end, actually.
Well, I think he said it both. That's kind of like his catchphrase.
Yeah, like almost as if he has no agency in his own decisions. He's just like, this is what has been fated. And at the end, she's like, it's not the coin, it's just you. And basically just calls him out on the whole way that he views himself and justifies how he can go around killing people.
I think the power behind that scene in the hotel room where, you know, the phone rings, you're seeing the shadow, I think those are things that, I think probably the power behind it is that for a viewer, it's really easy to latch on to. Right.
Yeah.
Oh, the phone's not being answered, so he must be dead. Like, that's the first thing that comes across everyone's mind. Or, you know, the light went off because you could see the shadow. So it in that moment, whenever those things start happening, because at first you're watching the shadow dance across the floor, and it's really creepy. It's kind of this prey predator type thing. And it seems like as soon as you think that, like, oh, you can see the killer's shadow, he turns the light off. So it's almost like the killer is in your head, the viewer's head, not only in Llewellyn's, but mm-hmm. but in yours as well. So I think it kind of acts to bring you into the movie a little bit.
Especially since we know what's going to happen, because we've seen him with the air cannon shoot out the lock of the door mm-hmm. several times from the other side. And then he stands there and we're like, it's going to happen. And then, shoom, and it shoots out and hits him in the chest or forehead. I think it's the chest.
I think it's his chest.
Yeah.
Yeah, Llewellyn.
Yeah.
Hits him in the chest.
And then you're just kind of like, oh, you're done for.
It's about to drop. About to hit the fan.
It is.
It was.
It is. We're going to keep this a clean podcast, I assume.
But to speak on your second point, I think, and I'm sorry, I'd have to ask again for what's the name of the killer? I don't want to just call him
Anton Chigurh.
Chigurh?
Yeah.
Okay. That's kind of a hard name to say. Yeah, he does kind of see himself as this agent of fate. And to me, it seemed that his character was, I don't know, his character seems to be directly contrasted with Llewellyn a little bit, because I think Llewellyn is very, what drives him is his choices and his belief that he can purposefully and intentionally change the way things are.
Yeah.
So he stumbles across the money and this drug deal gone wrong, and he decides to go back and save this man's life by giving him water. And that's what gets him into this whole mess.
But literally, like, hours later.
Hours later. But you could see that the reason why Llewellyn couldn't sleep is because he believed that he had a moral obligation to go back and save that man.
Yeah, he's a good person. Like, mm-hmm. the reason that he is so determined to keep the money is to give him and Carla Jean a better life, because mm-hmm. you know, they just live in this trailer home, and he's just constantly, you know, like, no good deed goes unpunished kind of thing.
You know, it seems like Chigurh and Llewellyn are really, you know, put against each other in that way, because really Llewellyn's really agent centered, and
yeah.
then, you know, Chigurh really is like, there's nothing wrong. He goes around like, you know, there's nothing wrong with what I'm doing. It's just fate. You're not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to be here. this is just the way things are.
Yeah, and one of the things that I think makes him such a great villain is that he definitely has a principled way of doing things. It doesn't align with any normal set of morals. So when he goes into the office to, you know, shoot the guy who's like the head of the business or whatever, and then the accountant who is just like, I'm nobody, and he's like, are you going to shoot me? And he goes, that depends. Do you see me? Because he doesn't kill him because, at least it's assumed that he doesn't kill him, because he has no reason to.
Yeah, he doesn't have a fight with, like, he doesn't have a bone to pick with that guy.
So. Yeah, he only kills people who he has to. I wouldn't say has to, but, like, to steal that guy's car, he didn't have to kill him.
Mm-hmm.
But he was in the way, you know. So only people who are sort of aligned with his mission. Yeah, so he's not just a random psychotic guy who just kills everyone. There are reasons behind what he does, and that's one of the things that I think makes him such a great character.
Mm-hmm.
I think that kind of reveals, you know, people like, for instance, recently in the news, people have been talking about the things that seem like senseless violence.
Yeah.
But I think what's even more scary in the world we live in is the violence that has very much a purpose behind it. Which is like what the villain in he's very purposeful. He's principled. He's methodical. He has a philosophy. When that's driving you to violence, I think that's even worse. And I think of course, the principal example of that is the Holocaust, right? There is some, in Nazi Germany, there are some very, very strong principles in that movement that led them to do what they did. And so, I think what I appreciated most about the movie, and I guess this relates to one of my favorite moments, is its treatment of evil. And it's kind of a different look at evil. Evil isn't evil in this movie isn't random, even though it seems like it.
What do you think the ending means?
So ending in regards to what? So the killer lives.
Yeah, right, specifically
out on top.
Specifically, that car accident and him walking away. The end of his storyline. What did you guys think that meant?
I think that ending just reeked of saying life is you know, more or less guided by random chance.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right, or at least it kind of seemed to fall into the philosophy of Chigar.
Yeah.
So because you know. If someone else would have written this story, eventually the bad guy would have died. The good guy would have ridden off with the money with his wife. You know, there is no karma really in this movie. It seems like the only reason that Chigar gets hurt in such the way that he is because he gets into this random car accident.
Yeah, that's like definitely a very central theme of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
That's why Llewellyn gets killed by some people who are basically side characters. And not the main villain. And that's how I interpret the ending, is that Chigurh fancies himself, like I said, this agent of fate.
Mm-hmm.
And I always took that as, if we're going to personify fate here, it's fate reaching out and saying, you're not immune from this either, you know, just because you do my work or whatever, you're still subject to me. The other interpretation of that ending that I've heard is, so Tommy Lee Jones's character, Sheriff Ed Tombell, he's an old man in regards to No Country for Old Men, the title, because he's in a world that he doesn't understand. He sort of longs for the nostalgic past where things made sense, and he can't handle this. So he's an old man. The other interpretation of the ending I've heard is when Chigurh has to ask those boys for help, has to tell them, say, I was already gone, has to buy the kid's shirt, that he is depending on them. He's no longer self-reliant, so he's become an old man. I'm not as big a fan of that ending, but it's definitely open to interpretation.
Yeah, because, I mean, the whole thing, he's basically like you guys said. The whole time, he's like, I just happened to be here when this coin was here. Flip, you just happened to die. That happens, you know, several times throughout. And then at the end, he's like, you could, you know, if you looked at a wider angle of it, be like, he just happened to drive through this intersection when this other guy did.
Yeah.
And it just proves the, his whole point, and basically it was like, everything's to chance, and, you know, Chikur's basically proven correct in that sense.
Yeah, in a way that is harmful to himself, even.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the middle of the movie, I wrote down, you know, is this villain maybe, and this is along the lines of what we're talking about, so this is why I think it fits. I mean, is the villain supposed to be just this stand-in for death itself? Because, I mean, all humans die. It doesn't matter if you lived a good life, if you lived a productive life, or if you lived an evil life. Death gets you eventually. Some people, good people die early. You know, evil people die at a ripe old age. There seems to be no rhyme or reason to the way that people's lives end. And so I think that the villain's character is just kind of a personification of that.
Yeah, that's definitely another interpretation of his character that I've heard. Mm-hmm. So did you guys have any specific moments that you really liked or wanted to talk about?
Well, do you want me to ruin the movie for you forever?
Yes.
The next time you watch it, watch Tommy Lee Jones's mouth, because when he talks, his top lip doesn't move at all. Not a single bit. It's only his bottom lip. He's just kind of like, and just like mumbles through his lines. I noticed it about halfway through, and I was like, well, we can just be done now. I'm not paying attention anymore.
Oh, man. So pretty much your favorite moment was any time that Tommy Lee Jones spoke.
Yeah, pretty much.
Essentially. I guess mine's on a related note. Mine was probably the very beginning, that opening monologue that Tommy Lee Jones does. I thought that was it. I had to go up and I went and looked it up at home later because I really liked it. And it ends, he's talking about how, you know, back in the old days, he wonders how the older sheriffs would have dealt with, you know, this kind of new twisted evil that's around today. And he says, more than that, I don't want to know how they would have. Man would have had to put his soul at hazard. He would have to say, okay, I'll be a part of this world. So it seems like, I don't know, his character is very reflective, and I suppose I appreciate that very much. But he recognizes evil as kind of this tangible thing. This tangible thing that's out there, it's real, but it's very hard to understand. Maybe because it reaches such and such a point that it's really out of line. I mean, a certain amount of evil is in line with human nature, but then there's some that's like, wow, how do you do that?
Yeah, like when he's talking to the sheriff in the one town, and he's like, how do you defend against it? They just don't understand it at all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so I think things like that are, you know, kind of refreshing. Takes like that in movies are kind of refreshing because, I mean, today this is a societal thing, but I mean, subjectivism is a big thing, right?
Yeah.
There's no, what's good for me is good for me, what's good for you is good for you, there's no really such thing as evil, and I think this movie says, yes, there is. I mean, there certainly is, and I agree with that.
All right, so that's No Country for Old Men. I could talk about this movie literally all day.
Yeah, we went 5 minutes over.
Yeah, so let's go ahead and move on to Tanner, tell us about the movie you chose.
All right, so here's what I want you guys to do. I want you to picture myself. I'm 11 years old-ish.
Okay.
I'm a young kid. And I have three younger sisters, for those of you listening who don't know that. And out in the living room, they are watching some princess movie. It doesn't matter what it is. And my dad's like, hey, come in my room. We'll watch a movie in there. And I'm like, all right. And we watch a movie, and he puts in a videotape, and the words flash on the screen, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. And then they fade off the screen, and then bam, na, 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 and it's the original Star Wars, okay, Star Wars A New Hope. And I loved it, okay? And then watch the next one, the fifth one, episode 5, and also just loved it. And we were walking around Walmart one day, and I saw Star Wars on sale on DVD for $5. And I was like, awesome. So, of course, I bought it. Turns out it wasn't Star Wars. It was behind the scenes how they made Star Wars. And I was a little bummed at first, But then it was like super interesting. And then I met the guy that actually filmed our movie, Austin Calum. We became friends, and he also loved movies, especially Star Wars. And so Star Wars, in a sense, started my love for movies so many years ago. So, you know, besides being an awesome movie, just holds that special place in my heart for being that the first great movie that I enjoyed. So that's why I love it so much.
And I think your story here brings up like probably a pretty big debate, I think, about Star Wars, is that, you know, most people when they see Star Wars for the first time, they're children. So is Star Wars viewed as good of a movie among people who view it for the first time as adults?
Well, that's my experience.
That is your...
Well, I was probably like 16 or 17 the first time I saw it, and I've seen A New Hope probably 4 times now, and like each time I saw it, I was like, yeah, you know, this is a good movie. And this is an experience I've had several times where I'll watch a movie that I've seen a few times before, but this time, for some reason, this is the best movie I've ever seen. And I had that experience watching this again for this episode. So I think it's not just a nostalgia factor. It really is a great movie.
I think I agree too. And I mean, my perspective is same as Tanner's. The first I remember watching A New Hope was when I was a very young boy. It was like probably 4. And I was over at a babysitter's, and every time I went to the babysitter's, I wanted to watch Star Wars. A New Hope. And kind of the funny thing was that, you know, I was only there for like an hour or an hour and a half or something. So I always got to the same point in the movie every single time. You know, back then it was on VHS. So,
yeah.
You know, it's not like you could just, it wasn't very easy to just pop it in and leave. I mean, if you rewound it. Right. It wasn't easy to just pop it in and take off from where you left off. So it started off for me something being very nostalgic as well, and I think it just kind of hooked onto you from there on out. So I think we're in agreement that it's a good movie, but maybe its home turf is, you know, kind of that childhood nostalgia. Yeah, mm-hmm,
for sure. So what are some of your favorite moments from this movie, Tanner?
Oh man, there's just too many. Why doesn't he share his? No, I'm kidding. the iconic scene when you first see Darth Vader, like one of the best movie villains of all time, just because you've got the smoke, you've got his stormtroopers, you've got the door that, and then you hear his breathing as he walks through the smoke, and you're just like, holy cow, this guy, he's going to be like the best villain of all time, and you haven't even seen him do anything. And really, in the movie, he doesn't do that much.
Doesn't he have like 12 minutes of screen time or something? Yeah,
like he's really not that much of a factor in this movie as much as 5 and 6. But, you know, just that introduction, just, hey-o, this guy's here, and it's gonna be a mess because of it. And just that whole thing. I mean, you have the awesome Princess Leia moment where she's like, someone has to save our skins, and goes into the trash compactor, and it's like, why are Han and Luke even here? Like, they're not doing anything.
All they did was press a button to get her out of her cell.
Yeah, like the worst rescue ever. Like, oh, shoot everyone, and we're fine, how are you moment, you know? And they're like, oh, that's not suspicious at all, but no, it's, yeah. Lots of great, there's just tons of great moments that when you look back, it's like the whole movie. Like,
yeah.
Every part of that movie is iconic in one way or another.
Yeah, I definitely was realizing this as I rewatched it. I was like, I think half of all iconic movie lines are from this one movie. Yeah. It's like every other line is like, you know, that's no moon. I find your lack of faith disturbing. You know, just so many things are in this one movie. Hokey
religions are no match for a good blaster at your side.
Don't get cocky.
Yeah. Great! If we're not careful, we're going to use up literally all of our time. Just
quoting lines.
Yeah. Which would just prove our point.
Sit down and just quote the whole movie. you were also talking about like all the things you see right at the beginning. One of the things that I was appreciating was, so I was trying to view the movie as people would have viewed it in 1977. Mm-hmm. This is the only Star Wars movie. You don't know there's going to be a sequel, you know, because even George Lucas wasn't for sure making a sequel. And from the first moment on...
That's a funny story, but you can continue.
Okay. From the first moment on, you're in a completely immersive world.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's fully realized, like, all the details are there, and it's all, like, it's all different, you know? Like, Darth Vader's outfit, the Stormtrooper's outfits, really, all the costuming, all the sets, it's just, it's all very different from what you would see in any real place in the world, and they had to come up with literally all of that from, not from nothing, but, you know, mm-hmm. it all had to be created, and I was impressed with that, watching it this time. Of how just immersive that whole world is.
Which, you know, for science fiction and fantasy, like, that has to be the most important factor, besides a good story. Like, if you don't have a good story, don't even try. But, like, if you look at, you know, I don't even know a science fiction movie that hasn't done well recently. But, like, this movie, like, George Lucas talked about, in this movie, like, he grew up with, like, Flash Gordon and things like that, where it was like, oh, their spaceship is bright and shiny and just came off the you know, conveyor line as it was made. But in Star Wars, like, you can see the nuts and bolts and things fall apart and they're dirty and lived in. And it's like, oh, yeah, this world exists somewhere.
It's in a different galaxy.
Somewhere.
far away.
Far away. Like, it existed, but no. Yeah, that's, like, the most important, most impressive and most important part of this whole saga now franchise, so.
I really resonate with what Zach said here, because when I watched it, too, I wanted to watch it as if it were, you know, the first time,
mm-hmm.
right? And what I quickly realized was that what's different about this movie compared to a lot of new movies, because, I mean, new movies, a lot of times, you know, they build up, you know, the scenes, right? They build up the context and everything like that. They give the viewer kind of a chance to learn what's going on. They let the context develop along with the viewer's understanding, right? But it seems like here with Star Wars, you're just popped into the middle of this huge conflict and everything's just kind of laid out before you.
Mm-hmm.
I think I have in my notes in here, I mean, it's literally a fairy tale, right? The Empire, in the very first credits, it says the evil Galactic Empire.
Mm-hmm.
They tell you right away, they're evil. Why? It doesn't really explain what their motivations are. They're just evil.
Yeah.
And so the rebels, well, of course they're good. They're fighting the evil Galactic Empire. Mm-hmm. So it's that good versus evil setup that's just like, you know, you don't question it beyond there. And so for that reason, it's kind of a fairy tale. It's kind of that setup because, you know, you're just thrown into the middle of this universe that's fully developed. And you're just kind of this nice, you know, person standing by and watching.
Yeah. Back to what you said about the opening, like, if you think about, like, the first time you watch it, like, the first thing you see this little bitty ship fly over, and you're like, oh, that's kind of cool. And then you see the Star Destroyer, and it just, you see the point of it, and it grows and grows, and it takes the whole screen, and you're just like, holy crap, how big is this thing? And it's really funny, one of the guys who worked on the special effects, specifically the ships, was like, you know, they were all real nervous about how it was going to turn out because, you know, the whole concept is just goofy at that point in time. And he said the movie starts and the ship goes and it just goes and goes, and he's sitting there going, holy crap, who worked on this? Like, and it was him that worked on it. Like, they had no idea how it was going to look. But yeah, I mean, the best thing about the movie is just, like you said, the way that it drags you in. Like the episode of That 70s Show when they go to see Star Wars and Red's sitting there and he's like, yeah, this is a bunch of crap. And then you hear like the most generic, almost similar noises that would be Star Wars noises. And he goes, whoa, this is kind of cool. And just like is sucked in just immediately. Like that's, I feel like, every kid watching it for the first time and probably like Zach, a lot of adults like, oh, this is stupid. Oh, this is awesome. Like, just that switch.
you might have heard this, Tanner, and I'll be super happy if you don't know this and I'm telling you this for the first time, but that that opening shot of the Star Destroyer,
mm-hmm.
so they use, like, miniatures, right?
Yeah.
And that Star Destroyer was supposed to be, I think, like, 40 feet long, and they ran out of money. And they're like, well, I guess we can only build a 4-foot one. So that was what they did, and that was one of the reasons why they didn't know how it would turn out. And yeah. Still, it looks amazing.
It does. I mean, depending on which version you look at, like, there's been some retouching, obviously. I mean, you've got the special edition ones that we just won't talk about. But, like, for the most part, like, the effects 100% hold up and, like,
absolutely.
Look worse when there's, like, a lot of retouching done. So.
And, I mean, am I correct in, I think I heard that for these newer Star Wars movies that they kind of went back to using those miniatures for ships and things.
That is true.
Rather than computer generate them.
Yes. Yeah. And you can absolutely tell. All right. So that is Star Wars. Daniel, why don't you tell us about the movie you chose?
Man, now I feel, like, inadequate because I don't have this huge lead up into it. I will say that...
That's my job, to make you feel bad.
Okay, well, you're doing it.
Yes!
Okay, mine comes from a lot of, you know, nostalgia and me growing up with my family as well. Because I grew up in a family where, you know, whenever we would be at my grandparents' or something for the holidays or something, we would sit around and we would watch the original Star Trek. And I guess by original Star Trek, what I mean is, like, some of the original TV series, not, like, the original with Captain Kirk, but I'm talking, like, Next Generation, Voyager, Deep Space Nine, stuff like that. So I have a lot of family who are, you know, good Star Trek fans. And so whenever these new movies came out, directed by J.J. Abrams and things like that, I was really excited for them. And so I'm not talking about the first Star Trek that was released in the new universe. I'm talking about Star Trek Into Darkness. And, of course, this has the great Benedict Cumberbatch as Khan. And so it's kind of a retelling of Star Trek The Wrath of Khan. What's happening here is that just to generally, you know, understand the plot, there's this man named Khan who is kind of secretly resurrected. He was in stasis or something like that, you know. And he was actually this, you know, super intelligent, genetically modified human that was made in the pre-warp age of Earth to be a super soldier. Before Earth had developed warp capabilities and before they had sustained world peace and things like that. And so what happens is that he pretty much rebels against the entire Starfleet and the people that, you know, resurrected him, and pretty much tries to destroy all of Starfleet. And I'm not the type of person to rewatch a movie over and over again, but I remember, this is burnt into my mind, like, the first time I saw this movie, I have never enjoyed a movie, seeing it for the first time, more than this one. And just because, I don't know, the acting is great, they take one of the most iconic Star Trek movies, The Wrath of Khan, and all of those things, and they kind of replay it out, but they give them their own twist, because, I mean, for those of you that don't know, the new Star Trek movies take place in an alternate universe to the originals. And so things are a little bit different. And so one of my favorite moments from that movie is when they have Benedict Cumberbatch, who plays Khan, and he's, you know, he's got this, he's tall, he's lanky, he has this deep voice that's just really intimidating, and they have him in the brig, and, you know, they're talking, I think Captain Kirk is talking with him, and, you know, he's trying to figure out what this Khan guy is all about, and up until this point, what's so great about this is that up until this point, you don't really know who Benedict Cumberbatch is playing. He's some sort of villain. He just blew up a library. Like, who blows up a library? And he just blew up a library for no reason. For all we know, as a viewer, he's a terrorist. And then all of a sudden, he's talking to Kirk, and he says, you know, I think his previous name was, like, John something. He was like, John was a name that they gave me in order to conceal my true identity. My name is Khan. And there's just this silence. And then people who are fans of the series will go, oh no. Like, I know that that's that what every Star Trek fan's reaction was whenever that happened in the movies. Like, oh my gosh, this is going to be a ride. Because, you know, Star Trek The Wrath of Khan, the original, is where Spock originally dies and those sorts of things. So, you know, that's my favorite moments. I'm curious as to what you guys took from it.
One of my favorite moments was when they're trying to get over to that other ship from the Enterprise, and mm-hmm. it's Khan and Kirk are just going to be, like, shot out of the ship. Mm-hmm. And that was, like, so tense the whole time, because it's such a long ride over there. Like, I don't know how long they're flying through space just in their spacesuits. And so many great things happen to just build and build the suspense there. Like, when Kirk's, when the visor on his helmet starts cracking, you know, you're like, is this gonna break and he's gonna die? You know, they, like, keep going off course. Scotty, who is a great character played by Simon Pegg,
yep.
is he gonna get the hatch open? And I love suspense, so that was one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie.
And I think what was really powerful about that scene is that there's suspense on multiple levels, right? They're in physical danger. They don't know if they're going to get back on path. They don't know if the door's going to be open. But also, this is right after, you know, Kirk is trusting Khan a lot by freeing him from the brig and allowing him to come with him to the enemy ship. So there's kind of like this uneasy truce that's being formed. So, like, the biggest, you know, threat, the biggest villain in all of the Star Trek series, temporarily, him and Kirk are partners. And so I think that just even builds the suspension, the tension even more.
Yeah, for sure. Because the reasons that Khan has to work with them are sort of tenuous at best.
Mm-hmm.
So you never know, like, is he going to turn on them? He could turn on them at literally any moment.
Oh, yeah. And of course he does. But
in true villain fashion, you could say.
Yes. Yeah.
So.
And I think probably one of the enduring things about it is whenever Kirk, I think he consults the... So this is crazy stuff. There's two Spocks in this universe, and one of the Spocks is old, and he's from the original Star Trek universe. He's from the Alpha timeline. And then there's the young Spock that's in this one. So Captain Kirk talks with the old Spock that's from the original timeline. He says, hey, did you, you know, come across Khan in your universe?
And it wasn't Captain Kirk, it was the other Mr. Spock.
Oh,
he comes
it?
On screen
oh,
and they're
yes,
like,
yes, yes.
Mr. Spock? Mr. Spock.
And of course, you know, that's a big comedic, you know, thing there. But yeah, yes, thank you for correcting me there. Yeah, it's Spock. And so he asks Spock, you know, were you able to defeat Khan? And the old Spock says, yes, but at great cost. And, you know, I think one of those things, every fan's mind goes back to Spock dying in that original, The Wrath of Khan. But in this one, it's exactly flipped around. It's Kirk who has to go into the radiation chamber and fix the, I think, I don't know what piece of equipment it was. It's maybe the nacelle or something mm-hmm. like that. It's something so that the warp drives would work or something, restore power. And so it's Kirk that dies instead. And so...
And then Spock, of course, gets the...
No! And then he screams, Khan! Which is just... Everything is just mirrored.
Yeah.
Which I think was just beautiful. Especially for a, you know, a modern movie that's supposed to... I mean, some people can think, you know, it's kind of cheap to really rely on a past movie so much. But I think the way that they did it was just really classy.
Yeah, and... That moment,
Force Awakens.
that moment when he's just like yelling Khan, I was like, I definitely could see like that line being super cheesy, and they pulled it off really well. And actually, I really liked that whole scene. Like, I was really feeling that death scene.
And that line where he says, "Is it Kirk that says in the end?" This is the thing that's always been. Spock has always traditionally said, he's like, you are now and always will be my friend.
Yeah.
And then I think Kirk dies, like, you know, right after that.
Yeah.
It's like...
It's pretty emotional.
I was
getting some feelings watching it. Especially because it's like, he's behind this door that technically they can open, but they can't. And so it's like, oh, you're so close. Like, you're literally one pane of glass away, and there's nothing you can do.
Except just watch.
Just watch. You just have to sit and watch.
And I think it's
grab a bucket of popcorn and just wait for his time to expire.
I think one of the things to be gleaned from that, as far as themes go, is that, you know, with Spock's line that we were able to defeat him, but at great cost. And there are some things that cost a lot, mm-hmm. but they're worth doing, because there's some things that just seem insurmountable, but they would do so much more damage if they weren't taken care of. And so I think that, especially if we think back to that original movie, it came like right after, you know, World War II, in the middle of the Cold War. And so it seemed like, you know, America was just kind of locked in these battles with just these huge insurmountable superpowers, and people were being asked to sacrifice their children and those sorts of things to war efforts and things like that. And I think the message there is that, you know, there's some things that are worth defeating at very great cost.
All right, any final notes on Star Trek?
I don't think so.
Mostly just Benedict Cumberbatch
being a boss. Yeah.
It's Benedict Cucumber Patch.
Yes, Bendy Bar Cucumber Patch. I could just listen to that man read the phone book, you know?
Yeah, oh man.
I love everything that he does.
Should have him and Morgan Freeman do a debate on anything.
Yeah.
It could be a debate on anything. We could all listen to it.
Yeah. All right, so that's Star Trek. Those are some of our favorite movies. And yeah, so that's what we had to talk about today. If you would like to keep up with the podcast or with anything else that we are doing, you can check out our social media pages. You can check out our Twitter at DogInTheWoods15. You can check out our Facebook and Instagram, which are both at The Dog in the Woods. If you have something that you want us to talk about, you can contact us there that way as well.
What about email? They could email us.
They could email us as well. That's thedoginthewood@gmail.com. Not thedoginthewoods. The Twitter was originally thedoginthewood, and it drove me crazy, so that was why I changed it. The email is just a typo.
What? The email, I thought, didn't have enough characters. I thought that was part of it also.
No.
That was Twitter.
Oh.
No. Just a typo. Just at the very inception of The Dog in the Woods. Made a very foolish mistake. Alright, so we just have one more thing.
One more order of business.
One more order of business. What would that be, Tanner?
That would be the joke of the week! Alright, so here's the joke of the week. Why?
You can tell it's going to be a good joke when the person telling it starts laughing after one word.
Why? This joke is just fantastic. I love this joke. Why does Edward Woodward have so many D's in his name?
I don't know, Tanner. Why does Edward Woodward have so many D's in his name?
Because otherwise, his name would be Ewa-woo-wa.
I think great that's joke. One of those jokes where at first you laugh because it's funny, but then you're just laughing at yourself, laughing at a stupid joke.
Yeah. Because it's like the dumbest joke that doesn't make any sense. Like, one parent is sitting there and they're like, we should name our child Ewa-woo-wa. And the other one's like, no, we need a few more D's. It's Edward Woodward. Like, none of it makes sense. Which is why it's amazing. This has been the joke of the week.
All right, thank you for joining us for our first episode, listening to us talk.
That's got to be a name of a podcast somewhere. Just listening to us talk.
Yeah.
If you get bored listening to us talk, you should watch our movies. That's probably more entertaining.
That's almost definitely true.
Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for listening, and we will see you in 2 weeks.